Hey, what is up guys, MKBHD here, and turns out the Google Pixel is one of those phones that you have to actually use to really fully understand how good it is. And that's real, like this phone, it's pretty uninspiring, right? The design's not that exciting, it's not turning any heads just with its looks or anything like that. But when you actually use this phone full time as a daily for a couple weeks like I have, that's a completely different thing. So technically, this is the first Pixel phone and not a Nexus phone because they're not openly putting another manufacturer's logo on it this time. So we had Nexuses by Huawei, by HTC, by Samsung in the past. This is the Pixel phone by Google. So you've got a Google logo on the back and it's made by Google, which is great, I respect that, but you should still know it's getting HTC to build it. And you can kind of tell, it has that HTC general design language, has some familiar antenna bands on the sides and on the bottom. And some have even said that this is actually the design of a body that HTC was working on before Google came up to them and said, hey, we want you to work with us on this Pixel project. Either way, this is what we get to showcase Android 7.1, a pretty plain Jane looking phone, mostly metal all around the body as you can see. And it does have a slight wedge shape, so it's a bit thicker at the top if you didn't notice. And it has some pretty tactile buttons on the sides with good placement and travel. It's also not the thinnest phone in the world, coming in at 8 millimeters thick. And I feel like you could land a 747 on those not very thin bezels as well. Again, maybe HTC was planning on doing something different there. And then it has this glass thing on the back. The two-tone design has split some people. I'm personally not a huge fan. I kind of like the way like the Nexus 6P handled glass on the back better. But it's fine, you know, having a glass section can improve signal strength, can be better with Bluetooth and Wi-Fi, so there's no wireless charging, so it's not for that. But yeah, it's just kind of this big glass window with no real shape. It's just kind of there. So obviously this is not my favorite smartphone design of all time, but if you want to spice it up, you can go with the really blue variant. That's an option you have, or you can cover it up at any time with the dbrand skin. And this one's actually really cool. They'll let you keep a cutout of the nostalgic Nexus logo on it. That's dope. Now, it's kind of funny hearing this phone is co-built by HTC because HTC was known for a while for having some of the best speakers in the business in mobile phones. They pioneered boom sound a couple years ago. And then here comes Pixel in 2016 with one of the worst speakers in a phone of the year. It's not very loud, it's downward facing, and it can sound decent when you're not blocking it, but it's just extremely easy to block with like one finger by accident. It's just bad. And that combined with no water resistance and no expandable storage kind of makes it seem like you're getting a not so premium build for a pretty premium price. But those couple missing features are not my least favorite part of this phone. It's literally just how boring it looks is my least favorite part. And maybe I've been spoiled because I've seen, you know, I played with the Galaxy S7 this year, played with the Note 7, we had the Xiaomi Mi Mix, even the new iPhone in all its matte black glory. But by comparison, picking up and holding and using a Pixel just doesn't feel future like the Edge displays or doesn't feel all that crazy. I mean, it's just, it's the way it looks. It's the industrial design. What you gonna do? But what's on the inside though is really pretty. Check out these specs. You get a Snapdragon 821 chip. You get the Adreno 530 GPU, 4 gigabytes of RAM, 32 or 128 gigs of storage. Yes, I went with the 128. And then you have the only difference between the Pixel and the Pixel XL, which is the battery size and the display size. That's it, which I like. So no handicap in the smaller phone to try to upsell you on the bigger one. But obviously you can see the benefits of having the larger Pixel XL, the bigger screen, the sharper screen, and the 3450 milliamp hour battery, but both of their batteries performed really well. So you guys already know you don't really need a ton of super high-end specs to make a pure stock Android phone run smoothly. That's kind of been its forte. But the Pixel kind of has those anyway. So I'll tell you right now, this is definitely the smoothest Android phone that you can get right now. Both out the box and way later, that's the first thing I noticed about this phone. Right out the box with Android 7.1, it's really buttery. And the battery life is phenomenal. So I did most of my testing with the Pixel XL just because I'm a big phone type of person. And this phone was regularly getting me 5+ hours of screen on time every single day. And you guys know my high intensity, high brightness, you know, Bluetooth streaming, all that type of stuff. My high intensity use usually craps out phones by the end of the day, but I was ending the day regularly with like 25%+ left on the Pixel XL. And the fact that you can also have a lighter day and end the day with like 40% left means the standby time was also very good. And then performance is top notch, as you should expect. We've seen other phones with lower end specs run close to stock Android or with lighter skins because that helps performance and battery life. But since it already has these beefy specs, Pixel is more of an optimized Android experience and is able to handle everyday use plus heavy multitasking, constant browsing, games, and back again with no hiccups. This is one of those phones that's super smooth way after the day you take it out the box. And for all this, you can thank Android 7.1. Out of the box, the Pixel is just so clean. There's hardly any pre-installed apps, and the ones that you do get can be uninstalled. It definitely doesn't have many of the bells and whistles of the Galaxy S7, for example, or should I say the flash bang of the Note 7. But it's a great performer, you can't hate about that. That's what the stock Android experience has been so good at for a while. What it adds to the mix is stuff like Google Assistant. So now you can argue it's not really adding that much since most of its features like voice control and stuff like that were already in previous versions of Android. But on a Pixel, it's just that little bit more accessible. You can long press the home button at any time or just at anywhere say, okay, Google, which I, by the way, love saying in videos because it always triggers someone's phone. But overall, Assistant is really helpful. And a lot of the features you can see in the video that I dropped comparing it directly to Siri. There's also little adjustments to Android, like the new buttons at the bottom, the slightly cleaned up settings app, you know, the new launcher where you swipe up to get to your apps instead of hitting a button. These are all things that you don't really think of right off the bat, but you get used to them pretty quickly. So when trying to figure out if Pixel is actually a great smartphone, if it's worth spending the extra couple bucks on, you might want to consider my five pillars of a great smartphone, which I've gone over before. First, great build quality. Well, it's metal all around, it's pretty solid. It's missing a couple things, it's not water resistant, so it's okay. Great performance. Yes, this definitely has that, no question. Great battery life. Yes, again, this actually has that, one of the best in any smartphone. Great display. This is actually also a pretty solid display. It's an AMOLED. It could be a bit brighter. It's not the best in class, but it's pretty good again. And a great camera. Oh, the camera on this phone. Yeah, this camera is pretty special. Pixel is rocking a 12.3 megapixel camera, all right? No optical image stabilization, but an f2.0 aperture and a pretty big sensor with a 1.55 micron pixel size. Before the phone launched, Google hyped it up again, saying they're pumped about what they've done with it. It's got the highest DxO mark rating of any smartphone camera again. But we've heard this before, like, does that rating even matter anymore? Well, bottom line, yeah, this is a really good camera. I've shared a lot of photos from the camera in the past couple weeks since I posted the unboxing video, and people are constantly impressed with the quality. I even did a blind test on Twitter with the same photo angle from the Pixel camera and the iPhone 7 Plus camera, and plenty of people couldn't decide which was which. The number one main reason that the Pixel can take such good photos is actually the image processing. I mean, it's a pretty great sensor and all, and that's nice to have, pretty decently wide aperture, but HDR Plus is really important here. So remember back in like the Nexus 5 review when I told you guys, even though it takes like an extra 2 seconds, turn HDR Plus on because those photos look way better than the non-HDR Plus photos and you get way better colors, dynamic range, sharpness, detail, quality, everything, right? This holds true again with the Pixel camera, but this time it's a no-brainer because auto HDR Plus can be turned on by default and the Snapdragon 821 makes it instant. You can take all the exposures of an HDR Plus photo instantly in the same amount of time as a regular photo. So just turn auto HDR Plus on, leave it on all the time for every shot and you will get much better photos with every photo out of the Pixel camera. So a typical photo from the Google Pixel is pretty bright, slightly wider angle, I would say, has a really bright, vivid, saturated colors, and excellent dynamic range, and has an occasional lens flare. I think the colors look great. In terms of realism, photos from the Pixel tend to have more accurate, like, reds and greens than most cameras that go for that more saturated look. And then there were quite a few photos that I took that made me literally say wow out loud after I took them. This is one of those photos. Now, it might not look crazy at first. It's not like a scenic landscape, but consider this. This is taken from a car window. I rolled down the window. The car is going 50 miles an hour. The truck next to me is going 50 miles an hour. And everything is in perfectly tack-sharp focus. Colors are super good. The action is all frozen super well. And the dynamic range with the blue sky, holy crap, that is good. And one of the worst thing about this random snap out of a moving car window is the lens flare that can apparently be fixed with a software update. I think we got a winner. Now, yes, the lens flare is pretty common. I don't know how much of it can be fixed with software like Google claims because lens flare is caused by hardware and physical lens elements, but I don't really care. I love this camera enough and the photos it takes with it are good enough for me to say that this is my new favorite camera in any smartphone, right up at the top of my list in first place. The 4K video from the Pixel also looks pretty good if you're a person that shoots a lot with their phone. I did a whole video shot just with this camera, so I'll link it below. It's the video on Apollo, and it looks pretty good. I think the main thing you'll notice while watching is the stabilization. So like I said, the camera lacks optical image stabilization, but the app actually uses data from the phone's gyroscope to provide an improved electronic image stabilization. But it's super aggressive, as you can see, so it can sometimes make it look so smooth that you'd swear I was on a tripod, even though I'm holding the phone with my hands. But other times when it tries so hard to smooth it, it can look a little jittery because your hands are moving too much to keep a stable image. So it's a little distracting sometimes, a little bit beautiful at other times, but this can also be improved with a software update. I think the weirdest part can be how much of a crop you see in the viewfinder versus the final stabilized video, since as you know, having a lot of electronic image stabilization means you get some of the framing punched in a bit. All right, so going back to the original five pillars of what makes a great smartphone, the only thing that the Pixel isn't great or best in class at is the industrial design. You know, it's not water resistant, it doesn't have expandable storage, the speakers are bad and in a bad place, and it's just so boring. But all that just melts away when you actually use the phone, the software, the pure Android, the assistant, the great camera, all of that works so well. So with all that being said, I think Google Pixel is right now my favorite smartphone experience, tops in my book. There, I said it. So is it worth the price? I think that by challenging other flagship smartphones at this, you know, the $600-$700 price, it's gonna price itself out of a lot of other people, because if it shows up in a store next to, you know, the Galaxy S7 or a Note 7 or all these phones that have these crazy bells and whistles features or edge displays or just things, iris scanners, things that make you say, wow, the Pixel's just gonna sit next to it and not really look like it's gonna do anything special. So for a normal person, they'll probably skip over it. But for an enthusiast, for someone who's made it through this entire video and trying to figure out what smartphone to buy, looks on YouTube and tries to find the best option, this is definitely a great pick. And hands down, I have no problem recommending it. So there you have it. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you guys in the next one. Peace.